Welcome in the last part of today. The last part is going to be about glass sensor. Why we want to use glass sensor? Well, we want to use glass sensor because they are way more sensitive than paper sensor. And that's because I can use the microscope. We can go even possible to single molecule detection with a good microscope. The other point is that now I can use the background of the slide, so the black part that you will not see in fluorescent, as an internal standard. It's not anymore only qualitative, so yes or no, but now I can start quantifying my analyte with using glass sensor. I will need less reagents because I don't need a lot of water or a lot of analyte for flowing through a paper sensor, but I just need one droplet. On the cons, they are more difficult to make and they are very fragile. So if I'm using a thin glass slide, I can definitely not throw it from an airplane and hope that they will survive. How to make them? If you did the previous course, well, you already know how to do them. And that's just microcontact printing. And those one are the slide that you did during the first course. Not perfect, but at least you can see the stripes against the dark background. And this will help you a lot if you want to quantify the analyte on the glass slide. Microcontact printing, if you remember, it works just by having a small stamp in PDMS. You put your ink, that it's your molecule, on top, and then you just physically stamp it on glass. If you have a reaction happening, then you're making a covalently attached layer on top of the glass. It sounds simple, but actually it is not. So if you did the previous course, you know how difficult it can be to microcontact printing something on top of the slide. You don't know how many molecules are on your substrate. You don't know if you have to oxidize or non-oxidize your stamp. You don't know a lot of things. There are quite a lot of variables in the microcontact printing. But you will have an internal standard, which is pretty amazing. And it's not only one single internal standard. You have a lot of different internal standards. So if you are printing lines, I have a lot of different black lines, which will be my internal standard. So I have a way more accurate way of quantifying analytes on the surface. Which reaction can be used on glass? It's exactly the same of paper microfluidics. It's still a salinization reaction. So you first oxidize your stamp for having hydroxyl group on the surface, and then you use silane for attaching those molecules on the surface. Exactly the same reaction. So hydroxyl, silane, and you have your final covalently attached molecules. That's not all the only reaction that you can do. Once you attach your silane, then again, you can do a lot of different reactions directly on surface. The best one, of course, are click chemistry reactions. So click reaction that works more or less with 100%, should at least work with 100% yield, and they should be fast and without any side products. So for example, you can go for the click in reaction, and then after that, this one, the second one, it's a succinamide, and then after that you can attach even more molecules. And there are plenty of those reactions. So you can go for a classical click reaction, but you can, for example, use also the DL solder, but also a lot of different reactions that can happen on surface as well. You can also use non-covalent interaction on surface, and this is standardly done with the avidin-biotin complex. Streptavidin is a protein that contains four different sites for the recognition of biotin, and their binding is super high. Usually you put the biotin on the surface, then you put streptavidin, and the streptavidin will have also another empty spots for binding biotin on top. So what do? You put biotin on surface, then you flow streptavidin on top, and then I can use whatever other ligand I want on top of the surface. And this is most of the case used, for example, for binding proteins or any other biomolecules which can be tagged with the biotin. Using this method, you can use the ELISA on glass. So the same methodology that we've seen before, you can use a sandwich ELISA test, but on glass. As I told you, or as you have seen probably in the first course, it's really difficult to make those lines precise, and because you have a lot of different variables. We reached the same conclusion. It's really difficult to repeat the stamping process, and this is why we develop another method. In this method, you functionalize the whole glass slide with simple chemistry, and instead of stamping, you use now the PDMS on top for protecting some part of the surface. You put this in a plasma oven. The plasma oven will destroy everything, but the things that you protected under the PDMS. So once you finish the plasma treatment, you remove the PDMS and you have the protected slide which are still there. Most importantly, if you move your stamp between one plasma and the other plasma treatment, you can really reach very small features on the glass, which are extremely difficult if you want to microcontact printing them. So we can reach micrometer features without using any clean rooms or without using any particular machine. And we have seen reaction on papers, we have seen reaction on glass, and exactly the same methodology you can use also for modifying PDMS. Exactly same reaction, exactly same components, but you can use it on PDMS as well. Make hydroxyl, put a silane on top, they will react, and now you have a covalently attached molecule on PDMS. At this point, one will think, okay, glass is pretty perfect, I can use the microscope, it's way more sensitive than paper microfluidics, and I can quantify my analyte. So, looks perfect. What's the problem here? Apart for fragile and apart for difficult to modify. The problem here is that you need a lot of cleaning steps. And again, you did this during the first course. You modify, you make one reaction, then I need to clean it. I need to put a second solution on top, or I need to make another microcontact step. Then I need to clean it again, and so on and so on. So there are a lot of intermediate steps before reaching a proper working sensor. And this is, on one end, time-consuming, because I have to wash every single time. And on the other end, it's also more difficult, because every single step that I make, I risk to break the glass. If you are using a very thin glass slide, every single step, you need to pick it up with tweezers, you need to wash it, you need to dry it, and you need to do it again. So there are way more possibilities that you are breaking the glass in one of those steps. What would be the best way for moving solvents around on the glass directly on the microscope? Well, obviously, microfluidics. So if I have my glass slide and I have pattern on it and I have a microfluidics on top, then I can just flow liquid in and out. So for each single reaction, I can just change my syringe outside and I can make a new reaction. That will be the ideal solution. Making those microfluidics with pattern inside, it's really difficult. So there are a lot of steps involved in making those microfluidics. Luckily, also this, in our laboratory, we did it in a pretty straightforward way. We used the same methodology that we used before. So we used the plasma oven for making the patterns. And after this, we just attach a piece of PDMS on top for making a microfluidics. Now you have a microfluidics, which is made of PDMS and glass, and you have your channel inside, and inside the channel you have your pattern. So now I have a sensor, and I have microfluidics for moving liquids around. This is pretty interesting, but in 2 weeks we will see a lot of different microfluidics, how to make them and how to use them. And with this, I would like to conclude this day what we have seen. We have seen different chemicals, how they work with complexation or reaction. Also in the laboratory at home, we will see how those chemical works. We have seen, or actually on Friday, you will tell me why we are using nanoparticles for paper sensors. We have seen one main reaction, how to immobilize reactants on top of glass, on top of PDMS, or on top of paper, which is practically the same. We've seen the difference between covalently attached and physiosorbed, and a little bit of bioconjugation, so how to use the biotin and avidin complex for binding more molecules. On device, we have seen how to make a paper device, how to make a glass device. We have seen in depth how the lateral flow system works. I've shown you some origami paper microfluidics. At home, you will use your smartphone for making detection of different analytes, a calibration curve. And most of it was the difference between paper sensor and glass sensor. So thank you for being here and see you next week.